Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our communion service on this, the first Sunday after Trinity. I'll say a short prayer and then we'll go with our formal greetings. Heavenly Father, thank you for your love and your grace and your faithfulness to us. Thank you for your heavenly fatherhood, for your guidance, for your presence with us. We pray that you will meet with us today, that we will encounter you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We pray that all that we think and say and do here this morning will honour and glorify you. Amen. So grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
We say together, Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom the secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our opening hymn, Dear Lord and Father of mankind.
Thank you.
As we celebrate the presence of Christ in word and sacrament, let us call to mind and confess our sins. Father God, may your ways be known on the earth, your saving power among the nations, your forgiveness among your people. Father, have mercy.
Father, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, heal our wounds of sin and division, jealousy and bitterness. Shine the light of your word in our lives. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Holy Spirit, make one the torn and divided. Lead us and teach us godly truth. Spirit, have mercy.
Spirit, have mercy.
God, the Holy Trinity, be gracious to us and bless us, and make your face to shine upon us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
We stand and we will say the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of God, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Do you please sit for our collect for the first Sunday after Trinity. O God, the strength of all those who put their trust in you, mercifully accept our prayers, and because of the weakness of our mortal nature, we can do nothing good without you. Grant us the help of your grace, that in the keeping of your commandments, we may please you both in will and deed, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We now have the first of our readings.
Old Testament reading from the first book of Kings, chapter 19, verses 1 to 15. Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets of Baal with the sword. And Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, "So may the gods do to me and more also, if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by this time tomorrow." Then he was afraid, and he arose and ran for his life, and came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness, and came and sat down under a broom tree. And he asked that he might die, saying, "It is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am no better than my father's." And he lay down and slept under a broom tree. And behold, an angel touched him and said to him, "Arise and eat." And he looked, and behold, there was at his head a cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. And he ate and drank and lay down again. And the angel of the Lord came again a second time and touched him and said, Arise and eat, for the journey is too great for you. And he arose and ate and drank, and went in the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the mount of God. There he came to a cave and lodged in it. Behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said to him, What are you doing here, Elijah? He said, I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away. And he said, Go out and stand on the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore the mountains, and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Behold, there came a voice to him and said, What are you doing here, Elijah? He said, I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away. And the Lord said to him, Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A New Testament reading from Galatians 3:23-29. Now before faith came, we were held captive under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. So then, the law was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's offspring heirs, according to promise. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We're going to sing our second hymn now, We Walk by Faith and Not by Sight.
Precious words draw.
The Gospel reading comes from Luke, chapter 8, verses 26 to 39. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When they sailed to the country of the Gerasenes, which is opposite Galilee, when Jesus had stepped out on land, there met him a man from the city who had demons. For a long time he'd worn no clothes. He had not lived in a house, but amongst the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell down before him and said in a loud voice, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me." For he had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man, for many a time it had seized him. He was kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles, but he would break the bonds and be driven out by the demon into the desert. Jesus then asked him, "What is your name?" He said, "Legion," for many demons had entered him. Then he begged him not to command them to depart into the abyss. Now a large herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside, and he begged him to let them enter these. So he gave them permission. When the demons came out of the man and entered the pigs, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake, they were drowned. When the herdsmen saw what had happened, they fled and told it in the city and in the country. Then people went out to see what had happened, and they came to Jesus and found the man from whom the demons had gone, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. And those who had seen it told him how the demon-possessed man had been healed. Then all the people of the surrounding country of the Gerasenes asked him to depart from them, for they were seized with great fear. So he got into the boat and returned. The man from whom the demons had gone begged that he might be with them, but Jesus sent him away saying, "Return to your home and declare how much God has done for you." And he went away proclaiming throughout the whole city how much Jesus had done to him. This is the Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let's pray. Father God, thank you for all that you've given us. Thank you for your Son, for his salvation, for your word in Scripture. We pray that you would speak to us now in our hearts, our minds, and our spirits. Draw us closer to you and to one another. Amen. Well, that gospel is quite an amazing narrative of what Jesus did in what is now modern Jordan. For us here and around the world generally, things look and feel a bit grim at the moment. And when we find ourselves in that kind of situation, we often sort of come over all stoic and say, well, that's just the way things are. We put our heads down and get on with it. Though sometimes we think, well, actually, that may be the way things are now, but they don't have to be like that. And we'll maybe put a bit of work into changing things, hopefully for the better, but as we know, that doesn't always work out. In our gospel reading, Jesus shows just how radically different things can be, and how unexpectedly different things can be when he is involved. Jesus had been wandering around Israel for a while, teaching and healing, and it'd be worth reading from the beginning of Luke 8, at least, to get a picture of what had just been going on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. As a result of what Jesus had been doing and teaching, people had begun to get the idea that Jesus might be the Messiah that they were looking forward to and longing for. However, in going over to the region of the Gerasenes, meeting a madman who turns out to be possessed in a cemetery next door to a pig farm is about as beyond the pale as you could get. The Messiah was the Jewish Messiah for the Jews, the ritually clean, kosher people, not those who were living the other side of the Sea of Galilee. This place was outside Israel, a Gentile region, a place that's unclean, with a deeply unpleasant Gentile next to a pig farm in a cemetery. It's really hard to build a picture that's worse. The Messiah, everybody knew, as everybody knows these kind of things, would never go to such an unclean place or situation, and would never get involved with such an unclean individual. Everybody knew that Messiah wouldn't offer God's saving love to the Gentiles. God would only offer his love to his chosen people. Well, it turns out everybody didn't know. It turns out that Messiah would and did. It turns out that God's love in Jesus doesn't exclude anyone. It doesn't even exclude people here in Ledbury, here in St. Michael's. God's love does not exclude anyone. His love in Jesus is life-changing and life-transforming, then and now, for them and for us, and even for those we consider the worst of us, whatever picture that might bring in your mind. With Jesus, we've shown that things can be different. He is big enough, he's strong enough, he's wise enough, he's compassionate enough. He's powerful enough to offer, to bring, and to provide change. To transform us, situations, from the inside out. When Jesus encountered this frightening man, the man whom chains could not contain, the man who wandered around naked in a cemetery, pretty much the first thing that happened was he came and threw himself on the floor before Jesus, propelled by the legion of demons that possessed him, who begged Jesus to be gentle. No negotiation here, this was just abject pleading, please be kind, please be gentle. Why? Because the demon had recognized who Jesus was. As he said, the Son of the Most High God, God in the flesh. And because they recognized it, they understood his power and his authority. They begged not to be sent to the abyss, which is their final, resting place would be the wrong word, but where they will spend eternity in punishment, the bottomless pit. They knew that's where they would end up. They didn't want to go there any sooner than they had to, pleading instead to be allowed to enter the nearby herd of pigs. And Jesus, with graciousness, allowed that. And then the pigs went headlong into the sea. People say pigs might fly. Well, that day they did. The sea, by the way, is symbolic of the abyss. That's where you, when you go in there like that, you get destroyed. Now, we in the West, certainly over at least the last 75 years or so, have tended to be dismissive of the truth, of the reality of demons. We might accept them within TV series, films, etc., but in real life, nah. However, over the last 30 years or so, anthropologists worldwide have been looking into this and studying it, and have come to the conclusion that they observe spiritual possession being a common experience across cultures, geography, and time. How different cultures engage with that and package it does vary a bit, but anthropologists will tell you there is a spiritual realm, and it's not always good. So it would appear that our self-confident Western materialistic reductionism doesn't actually reflect reality. The good news, of course, is that Jesus overcomes that. He is rules over it. He is in charge. He doesn't have to give way to it. And in allowing the demons to enter the pigs, Jesus enables those invisible spiritual events to be witnessed in the physical world. We learn it wasn't just the disciples and the Jesus and the man, there were other people there who then rushed off to their homes to tell people what was going on. The demons going into the pigs like that opened a door, a window into the spiritual world through it being physical, showing the truth and the reality of the spiritual realm, and showing that he ruled there with power and authority. And when we come across the spiritual realm in the negative sense, we know that we can turn to Christ and he will provide his care and his protection and his power and his authority. As a result of this, that man was freed from being possessed and was healed from the consequences and damage that that had caused in him and to him. Ending up, we're told, in the most wonderful place, at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. A phrase which really sort of gives us a sense of quiet peace, a gentle joy, an engagement of body, mind, and spirit, and appreciation. What a contrast that is. He was in chains, both physical and spiritual, without Christ, and now was released and free with Christ. He was naked, mad, a man of the land of the dead, transformed by Jesus into a man who was clothed, sane, and alive in the land of the living. And then he gets sent to share the good news of how much Jesus had done for him. In one sense, you might say, he had been a dead man walking, and now he was a live man told to go walking and talking. But this is a picture that speaks to us well.
For we are dead in our sins without Jesus, and made alive and free through faith in him, by him. We see a contrast to the demons who begged Jesus not to send them away, with this whole healed man begging Jesus to let him remain with him. And yet, Jesus told the man who wanted to be with him physically to return to his home and declare how much God has done for you. In faith and trust, and I'm sure not a little sadness, that man obeyed Jesus, and he went and proclaimed how much Jesus had done for him. And in this little exchange, we see Jesus being revealed again as God in the flesh. Declare how much God has done for you. And we're told he did, and telling how much Jesus had done for him. Jesus is God, neatly announced there. But Jesus not only, as we've just seen, saved the man from something, but also saved him to and for something. He saved him from being, if you like, a member of the walking dead, to be a member of the walking living, to live a life of faithful discipleship. And those of us who know Jesus and are his disciples have been given that gift of life, that call to faithfulness and discipleship, and that relationship is something that Jesus makes available to everybody. In this narrative, we see Jesus Christ showing that there is no territory, no situation, and no person beyond the reach of his saving, healing, transforming generosity. Neither Jew nor Greek, neither slave nor free, neither male nor female, neither mad nor sane, clothed or naked, no one is beyond Jesus' reach. No one is valued more or less because they're clothed or naked, mad or sane, male or female, slave or free, Jew or Greek, etc., etc. All are valued by Jesus, and all are offered his salvation, healing, and wholeness, and a place in the family of Christ. No matter what weird place Jesus encounters us, all of us here have been valued, are valued. For Jesus to want us to know him and to receive his salvation, his healing and his wholeness. Jesus does not treat any as better or worse. He redeems and releases all people who accept his offer from the chains that bind us to serve him. The first Anglican Bishop of Liverpool, Bishop J.C. Ryle, said this: "Never is a man in his right mind till he is converted, or in his right place till he sits at the feet of Jesus, or rightly clothed until he has put on the salvation of the Lord Jesus." I pray for us that Jesus sets us all free from whatever chains bind us, mental, spiritual, physical, emotional. I pray that we may each know what it is to be fully in our right minds, at peace within ourselves through receiving Christ's peace as a consequence of turning to him in repentance and faith. and receiving his forgiveness and healing. I pray that we each sit at Christ's feet, listening open-heartedly to his word. And I pray that we may each know the richness of a lively, saving faith, and so a continuing relationship with Jesus. But we don't get just to stay at his feet, enjoying the moment. He calls us to live lives that honour him and build his body, grow his kingdom, and for us to grow in our faith in him. So I pray that we may all share and declare how much Jesus has done for us in our homes, in our cities, in our country, wherever we find ourselves, that others may come to know him and experience the freedom that Jesus only gives, that we see so dramatically in this moment. And may we remember and pray for this to happen for people and in places, no matter how unlikely we may think they are, no matter how unlikely, how unworthy they think they are. For some people, they are convinced, because everybody knows, but of course God wouldn't offer his salvation to Boris Johnson. On the other hand, others are equally convinced, because again, everybody knows, God wouldn't extend his saving love to Keir Starmer. And I'm sure you can come up with your own caricatures of people, but no. Just as much as God reached out to you and to me, in love and grace, he will reach out to everyone. And may we go out there proclaiming what Jesus has done for us, drawing many others to know him. Please stand and we'll proclaim the Church's faith in Jesus Christ. Together, we believe and declare that our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is both divine and human. God of the being of the Father, the only Son from before time began, human from the being of his mother, born in the world.
Fully God and fully human, human in both mind and body.
As God, he is equal to the Father, as human, he is less than the Father.
Although he is both divine and human,
he is not two beings, but one Christ. One, not by turning God into flesh, but by taking humanity into God.
Truly one, not by mixing humanity with Godhead, but by being one person.
For as mind and body from one human being, so the one Christ is both divine and human.
The Word became flesh and lived among us.
We have seen his glory,
the glory of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Amen. Do please sit or kneel, and our intercessions today are led by David. Let us pray.
Our gracious God and Father, we give you thanks that in the holy and the alone worthy name of Jesus, we can present our prayers, knowing that you hear and answer us. So praise, honour, worship and majesty be given to you and to our Lord Jesus Christ, who has lived amongst us, died to save us, risen victorious over death, and intercedes for us at the right hand of the the Father on high. Today, secular society celebrates Father's Day. But every day, the Church should celebrate God as our Heavenly Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. Furthermore, we celebrate Easter every Sunday, because Jesus rose from the dead on the first day of the week. Lord, in your mercy, hear us our prayer. Almighty Father, we pray for our town, our country, and our world. It is a world that has either rejected the gospel and failed to take seriously the call to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. Especially remember nations such as Ukraine and Myanmar, suffering through mindless aggression and demonic pride. May the peoples of these nations be enabled to defend their sovereignty and way of life. We ask that clergy and pastors be helped in such circumstances. We pray for our government. They will be open to the will of the population and the counsel of God's Spirit. We ask for justice and truthfulness to prevail. Likewise, we ask that our local council be always guided by these principles. We ask your help and guidance to all the members of our town council. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We commit the ministry of Keith, our rector, Reverend Tony Hodder, and Mary Ann, our reader, and retired clergy that contribute to the ministry here. In addition, we thank you for our church officers and council. We ask that you guide and direct each and every one in their Christian lives. Strengthen, lead, and direct them for the upbuilding here and at East North. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we bring before you those whose names appearing on our notice sheet, who are suffering ill health or worries about their family's health needs. And to that, we include the name of David Cadderwald, who is suffering a great deal of pain and discomfort at this time. So we ask that they may know your help in their situations as they seek your will. We remember our friends and family members who face similar difficulties. Where possible, enable us to be able to offer both practical help as well as our prayers. For all these people, we ask that they may be drawn closer to you, the God of all comfort. Finally, we pray for ourselves that we may all grow in the likeness of our Lord Jesus Christ, therefore fulfilling the mandate of the Church to witness and to make disciples, both in Ledbury and around the world, through our prayers and gifts. And so we gather our prayers together as we say, Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you please stand for me? Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and we share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let's share a sign of Christ's peace with one another.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Fellowship with one another.
us over refreshments at the end. But now, in the peace of Christ, let us give thanks with a grateful heart. Let us give thanks to the Holy One. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty, for everything in heaven and on earth is yours.
All things come from you, and of your own we give you.
The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Do you please sit down? It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son.
You embrace us as your children, and welcome us to come and eat with you.
In Christ, you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us.
He opened his arms of love upon the cross, and made all the perfect sacrifice of sin.
On the night that he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we give you this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life.
End of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all.
As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son.
As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord.
With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this, the sacrifice of praise, and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven, saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Glory be to you, O Lord Most High. Amen. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Most merciful Lord, your love compels us to Christ.
Our hands were unclean, our hearts were unprepared. We were not fit even to eat crumbs from under your table. But you, Lord, are the God of our salvation, and share your bread with sinners. So cleanse and heal us with the precious body and blood of your Son, that he may live in us, and we in him, and that we, with the whole company of heaven, may see fit to meet in your kingdom. Amen.
Before I invite us to take part in the Lord's Supper, we continue to have communion offered by intinction over there, and we have communion through bread and wine, wine from the chalice up at the communion rail. If you're coming up, please come up on the pulpit side and come back down on the lectern side. And if you are coming up, you don't need to queue behind the people who are waiting to go over to Trinity to receive communion. If you don't wish to receive communion but would like a prayer of blessing from me, then do come up to the communion rail, put your hands like so, and I'll know to pray with you. But if you prefer to stay in your seat, that's fine as well. So now, draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Draw near with faith and take this sacrament to your comfort. Eternal Father, we thank you for nourishing us with these heavenly gifts. May our communion strengthen us in faith, build us up in hope, and make us grow in love for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we say together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Spend time in the power of your Spirit to live and work for your praise and glory. Amen. Our final hymn is, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder, known as How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
make you strong in faith and love, defend you on every side, and guide you in truth and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. A few notices, beginning with two bands of marriage. I published the bands of marriage between Adam David Abbott of Ledbury and Rachel Evelyn Mary Drury, also of Ledbury, and James Dean, single of Ledbury, and Kylie Jane Mitchell, also single, also of Ledbury. If any of you know any reason in law why these men and women, respectively, may not marry each other, you ought to declare it now. Heavenly Father, we pray for them, pray that you will bless their preparations for their wedding day, and that you will bless and guide them in their married life together. Amen. I see a tin queuing.
Thanks, Keith. Just the last bulletin on the reading of hymns for the to have in church for the Poetry Festival. We managed to record about 30 so far, and I think there are about another 20 that we need to record, many of you in church this morning. So I just need to arrange with you when, if possible, over the week ahead, we can do that in different ways. My big thanks to Benjamin for his work so far. If you can record it yourselves and send it to us, that'd be great. But otherwise, we can fix up a time when Benjamin or I can do that for you. David Houghton gave a summary of the Open Gardens event last Sunday on behalf of the Friends Committee, with a further donation this week. I think the final total is a profit of £950, which is wonderful. Thank you very much.
And now we have a special guest notice from Kate.
Good morning, everybody. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Great stuff. I'm here to invite you to a highly unusual and entertaining evening here at St. Michael's next Saturday. You may have heard that this year is the 150th anniversary of Vaughan Williams' birth. There are many events going on around the country to celebrate that. And we are holding a concert called From Pub to Pulpit, which tells the story of how many of the local traditional folk tunes that come from this country, and particularly this area, Vaughan Williams was born in Down Ampney in Gloucestershire, how they were collected by people like him and Cecil Sharp, and turned into some of the best known and well-loved hymns that we sing here in church, as well as into the highest of church music as well. So, in one programme, in one evening, our very own St. Michael's Church Choir, who you could also get the opportunity to hear tonight at Evensong at 5:30, are sharing the stage with two wonderful groups, Broom Dasher, an a cappella vocal group, and Coracle, a fantastically brilliant and highly amusing and entertaining instrumental trio. And together we are going to show how those melodies were originally sung and then taken up and played by the musicians and then handed over to the organist. And we will then, en masse, sing them as the traditional hymns that we know. So we need your help. You are a quarter of the programme. So I do hope to see some of you there next Saturday night. There are leaflets at the back, or please do ask me if you'd like to know anything more. Many thanks.
Hopefully you'd have, all of you who are on the email list will have received information about this, and there's information in your pulpit. In your pulpit? No, pew sheet. Now, what Kate omitted to mention, pub to pulpit, the event is kindly sponsored by Ledbury Brewery. There will be some beer, so we will live the whole experience. honestly, everything in moderation. So do come along, it's next Saturday. Doors open at 7 if memory serves me right, for us punters, for a start at 7:30. And as Katie said, we've got our monthly call in song at 5:30. In a moment, we shall have a dismissal, and there will be prayers in St. Anne's, and there will be refreshments in Trinity. I can't remember offhand who's down on the rota to be doing coffee this morning, but if it's you and you're here, please can you beetle there, because I'm sure there will be people who are thirsty, like me. And if you're not, and it's looking thin and sparse, could you volunteer yourselves to sort of help man the pumps, as it were? So, would you please stand? Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit.